Meeting of the Whittier Regional Vocational Technical High School for Wednesday, May the 13th at 7 p.m. I think our first order of business will salute the American flag. Will you please rise? Mr. Murphy will lead us.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. First order of business is public comment by visitors. Does anybody wish to approach the school committee and make a public comment? See anybody here? Okay. Move on to the next order of business. Approval of minutes. We have the April 8th, 2015 minutes of the public hearing on the FY 2016 budget.
Mr. Chairman, I move the approval of April 8th minutes.
Second.
Any comments, questions on the minutes? None being heard. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Unanimous.
Mr. Chairman,
yes,
I move
sir.
The approval of April 8th minutes of the regular school committee meeting.
Second.
Are there any comments or questions on these minutes? None being heard. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Unanimous. The treasurer's report.
I'll move to accept the treasurer's report.
Second.
Any questions on the treasurer's report? None being heard. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Unanimous. In the old business, we have the school committee self-evaluation. Still missing a few of the self-evaluation, so I'm going to wait until the June 10th meeting, and I'll give a report on all those that I have. So Lisa will be contacting you to help you try to get them in, and I can tabulate it. Okay. Reports and communications. Mr. Bradley.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, Superintendent DeRosa, and all other school committee members, including new student representative Saffron Fox. The baseball team has clinched a berth to the state tournament. With a record of 10-4, they are fighting for a CAC title and home field advantage in the playoffs. Some dominant pitching and powerful hitting has carried the team so far this season. The softball team has also clinched a berth to the state tournament. With an undefeated record of 13-0, they also look up to wrap up the CAC title. With some tough games to close the season, including some against Division I schools, the team looks to prove they are a top contender. The track and field teams are off to an impressive season. The girls' team is currently 5-1. Two girls have already smashed three school records in their events. The boys' team is undefeated with a record of 6-0. One runner on the boys' team broke the school record for the 400-meter hurdles. Both teams to look to finish the season strong and to be top contenders at the CAC meet as well as the state meet coming up soon. The lacrosse team is looking to be in good shape for a state tournament berth. With an 8-5 record, they are only two wins away from a tournament spot. Coming down the stretch will be important to win league games in order to contend for a CAC title. The yearbook club has completed their edition of the 2015 yearbook. It is currently being printed and delivery is expected by the end of the week. Yearbooks will be distributed to seniors at a luncheon on graduation day. They would like to thank everyone who helped in the school-wide effort to complete the project. The Peer-to-Peer Club is preparing for the annual Relay for Life event. The event will take place at Northern Essex Community College on June 12th, 13th, and 14th. This will be the third year Whittier has participated. The event raises money to support the American Cancer Society. Whittier has won awards in the past for their effort and hard work. The Multicultural Club will be setting up a table in the cafeteria on May 21st in observance of the United Nations Designated Day for Cultural Diversity. The initiative is to do one thing for diversity and inclusion. The club encourages all members of the Whittier community to do one thing for diversity and inclusion during the month of May. The Chorus Club continues to meet on Tuesdays and Thursdays to practice a cappella tunes. Four seniors are prepared to sing the national anthem at graduation this year. Plans for next year's musical are also being considered. The Model United Nations debate team is preparing for an upcoming debate this weekend at Northeastern University. Members have partnered up with peers to represent their designated country at the conference. The Environmental Club has had a very successful year with its paper recycling efforts. The Key Club attended the annual Key Club Conference, where members were able to make new friends and share experiences with other schools and clubs. They hope to use some of the ideas they picked up from others. Members also helped spread bark mulch at the Winnikinny Playground and planted flowers at the planning area near the flagpoles here at Whittier. This Saturday, members will be giving tours to the parents of the incoming freshmen. New officers were pinned, including one junior and four freshmen. On behalf of the senior class, I would like to thank the committee for all that you do for this wonderful school. We are so lucky and thankful to have school committee members that are dedicated and committed to making Whittier a place of enriched learning and endless possibilities. We really appreciate all of your efforts. I would also like to thank and congratulate Superintendent DeRosa on his retirement. Over your 8-year tenure, you have built one of the top vocational schools in Massachusetts. You and the school committee are a large part of this school's ongoing success. The future of Whittier and students looks promising. That's all I have for you today.
Thank you. Very good.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
This is an appreciation of your dedication from the school committee to you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Good luck in the future.
Thank you.
Scented soaps and
okay. At this time, on the reports communications, we have the Honorable Police Chief from Haverhill here to address the school board and guests.
Good evening, and thank you for allowing me the opportunity to briefly address the board. Superintendent DeRosa called me last month in regard to several questions that may have come up about how we bill out our police officer for the school. I was a little surprised, and when we spoke, it was very easily cleared up. You have, as you would expect, a senior trained police officer on staff here at the school, just like I have at the schools in Haverhill, the high school and one of the middle schools. Per contract, we have to pay a particular way, as do you, as do other police departments, based upon the way the contracts are written. For a police officer, like Officer Landry, the pay is $74,452.45 for his salary for the year. I believe we bill the VOTEC $73,500 this year for those services. So I'm not sure what the issue is. So we're willing to address any questions that the board has.
Mr. Wood. I have a question. And I actually had a question relative to the base salary versus the total salary on what we're out. So I did get the city provided me with a copy of the contract, the collective bargaining agreement. So I assumed the highest, that this individual was at the highest step of the scale, which is $1,034.82 per week. I also assumed they had a master's degree. So I bumped the salary by 25% to the base on that. I also assume that they had 25 years of service, and I gave them the longevity of $1,200. And that brought me to a yearly base salary of $67,263. If I add in the longevity, it brought me to $68,463. Now, we only have them 180 days. Obviously, as a 5-2 officer, they would work 260 days. So their per diem would be $263,32. If that was assuming top of the scale on everything, and obviously they're only here 180 days.
Why do you think they're only here 180 days?
That's all we're in service.
You don't have summer school?
We do have a summer school program.
My officer's here for your summer school program.
Just for the small summer school program, we use them year round?
You use them.
Okay.
Yes, that's number one. Number two, if you check the collective bargaining agreement, you will notice that there is a differential in there for the top pay officer. Mm-hmm. And that is comes out to about $10.35 a week, which is on top of the figures that you've already quoted, mm-hmm. which would bring that salary to $55,476.20. And if you add in the master's degree, which the officer has that's here, that's another $13,869.05, which brings that salary, well, as long as you're going through the contract, the officers are paid for their fifth and sixth week. Mm-hmm. As you know, officers work four on, two off.
Yep.
Officers that work a fifth and sixth week are paid time and a half on the fifth and sixth week. So that would be another $5,107.20, which brings the salary to $74,452.45.
Okay. That's what I was trying to figure out, is the salary yearly versus if we, are we, basically, do we, are we getting them basically year-round, 260 days as?
You get them whenever you want them.
Okay.
And we do our best to provide services to this, to the school, as we do to the city schools. And, you know, it's very hard for us to keep an officer on staff and say, well, you know, we're going to fund them for 130 days, 180 days, 210 out of 365, and we're not going to pay for the weekends and holidays or anything else, because when we dedicate an officer to the school, he has to be replaced on the road. And he's not replaced on a Monday to Friday schedule. They're replaced on a 4-2 schedule, because that's how the shifts work. So it's not a cut and dried thing. You know, you have to kind of look at the whole picture and make a determination based upon, do you get the value? If you do not believe you get the value, then you don't take a police officer here at the school.
Right.
I mean, I don't know what else to say.
No,
but
that makes perfect sense to me. And I was trying to figure out the, I didn't know if it's just the city that billed us, or if it was you that billed us directly, if it was like a similar
my,
to a city my charge administ- where the city says.
No, my administrative assistant, Pat Noonan, does the billing for the schools. We've been dealing with Kara since I came here in 2002. Mm-hmm. And the billing comes back to our budget because we have to backfill for the officers. So it comes back to us. It's not a charge off. Same thing with the school department, the Haverhill School Department. As a matter of fact, as a result of this, we actually found out that we were underbilling the school department.
Yeah, because it was a big
So difference. We are doubling the bill to the school department. So I thank you for that.
Well, I don't have any problem. I don't have any
that
problem
did,
with
that. That did help me out quite a bit. So I am kind of relieved.
I don't have a problem. I was just looking for the consistency. If that's
and,
what it is, then
and we
that's
do
what
have
we
it now. Have. So that is good. And I would say this. I've been the chief here since 2002, and I dealt with Karen Sarkeesian before Bill took over, Mr. DeRosa, and we've always had a great relationship. We are as transparent as we can be. There isn't a person in this room who can't call my office and say, you know what, I got a question about this, or this, and how do you figure that, or what are you doing here? As well as the superintendent, who I speak to on a regular basis. Same thing with Kara. So I don't want you to think that you have to wait for a board meeting to kind of ask these types of questions or anything you have, whether it be about drugs, gangs, our enforcement activities, things that we're doing with the school resource officers to kind of get them prepared for what they're going to face when they deal with children or students in the schools and the unique issues that they face. Anything you have, any questions you have, we like to consider ourselves cutting edge when it comes to how we deal with children in schools. And we don't just dump officers in schools that we don't believe are going to be able to excel and are going to be not only good role models to these students, but they're going to be able to have an impact on what these students are trying to accomplish. So we're very proud of that. We will continue to work with this school as partners as long as you would like us to. And again, if there's anything I can do or any questions that I can answer, we would be happy to come to these meetings as often as you like.
I just had one quick follow-up, and I thank you for clarifying that, because
sure.
When I asked it at the last meeting, there really wasn't a clear
answer. Yeah, I didn't think they
that.
Would, unless you have our contract, and even I go through the contract, and I'm not sure half the time what we're supposed to pay and not.
Yeah.
So that's why it's very confusing. When you look at the contract, you know, you look at the base pay, and you were right, it comes out to, well, what you didn't add is that starting July 1, there's a 1.5% bump in there for
yeah,
their pay. So
I did see that.
That kind of all goes up again also, but If you didn't know about the differential, and what the differential is, I used to get hazard pay and uniform pay and all of that, and that's now all rolled in as part of their salary. It's not given as month, as
a bumped up $26.50 or something. Like, so I did see that.
That's how that comes out to that number.
I was just, when I was doing it, I was doing the calculations. I thought it, based off 180 days, or even if we, that's how I didn't, you know. And so that was why I asked the question. One second question, not sure. Budget related, but what you had mentioned that I think is important for the coming school years for kids is, as you know, we face here locally and throughout the state of Massachusetts, a severe heroin epidemic. Are the officers, are we going to be able to potentially roll in some education that they can come in and talk to some of the kids about some of what's going on? I mean, because obviously Haverhill has an issue, as you know, and we're trying to address that in multiple phases. And it's not just Haverhill, it's everywhere.
Absolutely, it's a huge problem.
And I know it's the high school here, and I know it's important to get the kids at a young age, because sometimes it can be too late by the high school. They're already in the pills or whatever that they're using. So is there any type of thought to what we can do at that level where it is such a big community issue?
Well, actually, there is. And if it's the board's pleasure and the superintendent's, we can sit down with, I'm sure you have somebody that develops your curriculums.
Yes.
And if they want to put something together that we can do, whether it be at an assembly or with individual class or with particular students that the school department feels would benefit the most, we can absolutely put something together that is contoured to what you feel would work and how we feel would be the best approach to present it. So, yes, that's absolutely something we could do. And you would be cutting edge if you were to do that, because I don't believe that's something that anybody is really doing right now. So that would be something that we would be out in the front on.
I would absolutely like, you know, the committee likes doing, the superintendent. I think that's something that's just very important. You see too many young kids that lives are being torn apart, or you're seeing them in the obituaries, quite frankly, as you know.
I probably see 7 to 10 on average overdoses come across my desk every week. So we do have a big problem, and it's something that we need to address. And a lot of these overdoses or the heroin use, we find that they're, whether there be children with them in vehicles or in apartments or that type of thing, it's not like this is just single people or people without children that are doing these things. So it is impacting school-age children up through high school. So that is something that is absolutely on point and that we can do.
All right. I think that would, and I hope the committee, the reason why I mentioned that is I was at, we brought a speaker into the Haverhill schools, and one of the girls that was 12 years old started crying, ran out of the room, and she went up to the speaker after and hugged him, and she overdosed.
Finish that up so we get.
So that's why I want to really try to, if we could work together on a program.
We absolutely, all our police officers carry Narcan. All the fire department trucks have Narcan. School resource officer has Narcan. And, you know, it's now at the point where that's become another tool that we use on a daily basis. So, yeah, we do have a problem in this country. I wouldn't say it's a Haverhill problem or it's an Essex County problem or it's a New England problem. It's far greater than that. But it's something that we are all dealing with across the country, and it's something that we absolutely need to get in front of.
Thank you. Thank you for clarifying my question.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions for the chief?
I just have one quick one.
Yes, Mr. Early.
Chief, you have a great staff.
Thank you.
He's done great down here. I can remember hearing this, and I think it was Chief Brady at the time, some 15, 16 years ago when I came on. And the other advantage is we also have a cruiser thrown in there, too, which is a big thing. But I want to commend your staff because 15, 20 years ago, we had two officers down here most of the time, if I'm not mistaken. Mm-hmm. Am I correct, Mr. Superintendent?
That's correct.
Officer Hardy and Officer Moses.
Yes.
But we've come a long way, and, you know, we're on a pedestal right now, Scott, and the whole board. And I'm going to tell you, I'm proud of them.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. So am I.
Mr. Tech, no?
No, you answered the question. I just wanted to say that I'm satisfied with the pay of the officer. That's fine. And I also would want to hear some of the more positive things that your resource officer does. We're all aware of the horror stories, but I know that they they also do good things and trying to, I wonder if you can just sort of,
well, I actually,
30 seconds or less.
I would probably defer great stories to the superintendent and his staff, but I will tell you that one of the things that we encourage them to do is every opportunity for mentoring, take it, use it. Use everything as a teaching opportunity that you can. So that's kind of hammered into our school resource officers on day one. You know, we understand and we want to make sure that they know that everybody's looking at them, everybody watches them, and the way they carry themselves, the things they do are going to be pivotal in how they're able to perform and how they're viewed. So that's important to us. As far as the great things, usually they don't come back and kind of tell me. There's a lot of layers between them and me, so a lot of times I don't get to a lot of FaceTime with the SROs, but I know that the superintendent can tell you, because if they're not happy, I expect them to tell me, you know, he's not really doing his job, or he's just hanging around, or we're not getting the bang for our buck. And if that ever happens, I will tell you this, and the superintendent knows this, and Karen before that, I have no problem in bringing a new team in. You know, if you're not, this is a specialty job. This is a coveted position. This is a great job. And if you're going to have this job, then you're going to perform. You're going to perform here. The bar is high. So this is not a skating job. This is not where you go before you retire. This is where you go to make a difference. Because as we all know in this room, you're all here for the same reason. Our children are the future. And if we don't do right by them now, we're going to have a problem later on. So we're here to help.
Thank you. Just one quick thing, Mr. DeRosa. Chief, I know for a fact that the resource officer here is more than a resource officer. He has an unbelievable rapport with the kids, the students, even to the fact that they look at a person that they can even bring family issues to and know they're going to get the straight scoop, help outside the school. So as you said, you've raised the bar, and it's really telling in the school.
I will say this. The kids today, my son is 19. He graduated Ethics Aggie about a year ago. So they know whether or not you're sincere or not as an adult. They see through you in about 3 seconds. They have very good radar for that. So you really have to walk the walk 100%, and it's important that that's happening. So, you know, we appreciate the feedback if we're not meeting expectations in some manner. We want to know. We want to know we're doing a great job. We want to know we're not doing a great job. We want to know if there's things we can improve. It's like Mr. Wood said, if we can come up with a program to deal with some of the heroin issues and educationally, we're in. We want to do it.
Great. Mr. DeRosa,
if I can, yes, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to thank Chief DeNaro and the staff at the police department, because I think, and it's something that Principal Lynch always talks about, the fact that when students feel safe, when it's an environment that students and staff feel safe in, then learning thrives. And I think that the Haverhill Police Department has been an essential component of Whittier's success and very much part of Whittier's success. And the chief and I have always had very open, consistent, constant communication. Anytime he's called me or I've called him, it's immediate phone calls back. And again, I would like to publicly thank you and thank the members of your staff and your school resource officers, because we certainly have benefited from it.
And I do eat here at Poets Inn, so I do get the opportunity sometimes to see the superintendent on occasion unexpectedly, but you know, so I know the building. I live around the corner from the school here, so I'm always in the area, and it's a great school. We're very happy to have it here. I think you guys are leaders in what you're doing and how you're putting the programs out, and we're just very fortunate. So thank all of you for what you do.
And thank you very much.
Thank you.
Chief.
Moving on to the reports of communications, and I'll have the outstanding vocational student.
Mr. Chairman, William Yameen, if you'd like, why don't you go up to the podium, Bill? William Yameen is the son of William and Janet Yameen. He's excelled in the computer-aided design program at Whittier Tech, where his leadership qualities have led him to pursue and achieve numerous goals and accomplishments. He's ranked third in a class of 294 with a GPA of 4.22 in an honors curriculum. William was inducted into the National Technical Honor Society his sophomore year and is a John and Abigail Adams Scholarship winner for his MCAS performance. He participates in our cooperative education program and is employed as a drafter at Chesterton Industries. Bill's ability to lead others is inspiring. He has been a student representative to the Whittier School Council as well as student government for the past 3 years, a Mass Stars Leadership winner, a Skills USA participant, and president of the Key Club. In addition, he is a disciplined student athlete who was captain of both our national sectional finalist football team and outdoor track team. William's been accepted at UMass Lowell, Western New England Worcester Polytechnical Institute, and Wentworth Universities. And that's Mr. Yamin. I'd like to give him a letter on our behalf.
Yes.
Good for you.
Congratulations.
Next, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
We have Emma Bowens Hahn. Emma, do you want to come up to the podium? Emma is the daughter of Anka Bowes Hahn, is a studious, diligent student majoring in design and visual communications. She strives to reach her full potential and continuously projects leadership qualities. Emma is a member of the Whittier Yearbook Club. She plays a large role in production of the school yearbook, and she is a quality control manager, archivist, photographer, and layout artist. Her instructor considers her the glue of the project. In addition, she has produced the Whittier Class Senior 2015 T-shirt. She's ranked second in a class of 294, and she has an overall grade point average of 4.27, excelling in all honors curriculum since her freshman year. Emma is employed as a lifeguard, swim instructor, and events coordinator at the YMCA of North Shore in Haverhill. She's been accepted to University of Massachusetts Lowell's Francis College of Engineering with a major of chemical engineering.
Wow.
And that's Emma.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Very impressive.
Nothing like a chemie.
Mr. Chairman, we also have someone who you already know. We have Connor Bradley, who has distinguished himself as a hardworking, well-rounded, and remarkably dedicated student majoring in electrical at Whittier. He's ranked number one in a class of 294 students for the class of 2015. Connor distinguishes himself in many ways. He's president of the class of 2015, the student representative to the school committee, and a representative for the Northeast Regional Student Advisory Council. Connor is a three-season athlete and co-captain of each team, varsity football, basketball, and baseball. He's been a Boston Globe Player of the Week and a CAC All-Conference student. In addition, he is a Hugh O'Brien Youth Leadership Member, a peer mediator, member of the Interact Club, and a Skills USA competitor. He also volunteers with several community organizations. Connor plans to pursue a degree in business and has been accepted to Villanova University, University of Connecticut, UMass Amherst Honors Program, UMass Lowell, St. Anselm's, and University of New Hampshire. Connor will be attending Villanova University in the fall, and Connor is the son of Kevin Bradley, our athletic director.
Congratulations to all of you. It's wonderful.
And now,
Mr. Chairman,
if the wish of the committee, I would like to take out of order under subcommittee reports the recommendation for superintendent. I need a motion for that.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion on that?
Rationale?
Yes.
Part of the rationale is we have not accepted the superintendent's letter of resignation, and the executive committee did the other night. We accepted Bill's letter of resignation with regret, but we have to move that to the full committee. So as part of the executive committee report, that would be the first vote that we need to discuss. But anyway, on the motion.
Mr. Glenn.
Yes, I was here the night of the interviews, and couple things I didn't quite think was right. First thing was the questions that were asked of the applicants were provided by Mike Gilbert. They weren't questions that were a ride by a committee sitting down, coming up with their own thoughts, their own ideas, what their next superintendent should be able to answer for questions. I don't think it was right that, you know, we took a template and used it as is. I think it was just an idea that should have been used for the committee to come up with their own questions. So the substance of the questions, some of them were, I feel, were redundant. The other thing that I brought from this was when I was watching the process take place, I said, we have five people on this board who's going to make a decision of who our next superintendent's going to be when we have 11 towns in this community.
That's not true. Through the chair, by Mike.
Right. That's not true.
The executive committee is made up of the various subcommittees. And what we do, we voted what we voted to bring to you. We cannot decide it. So when number one, we had a motion.
Explain that, please. You cannot decide it.
We didn't make a final decision.
We
moved to bring it to the full committee.
Right, and what that does, my point I'm making is you had three candidates come to your committee interview. You got to see the pros and cons. You're bringing one for the rest of us to see. And that's denying the rest of the towns who weren't represented there to see the full package, to see who's available to us as a superintendent. We're getting one brought forward and said, this is the one we support. Please consider this one here. And I think that doesn't do justice for the full board, full committee. This is my opinion. This is not something I'm trying to push on every one of you.
Well,
but I want you to consider that there was only three applicants. Normally, in a situation like this, there's 25 to 35 applicants. They're reduced down.
Mr. Chair, point of order. Didn't you make a motion?
Yeah.
All right. Did someone second it?
Not yet.
Yeah, Tony seconded.
Tony seconded. All right.
That'll come under discussion.
Speak to the motion.
Right. Let me move forward here to kind of set the record straight. We did. A while back, I think before you were a member of the appointed member, the entire committee deliberated and voted to have an internal search. So that was approved by the full board, majority of the members here. So the school committee did move forward, and in the interim, Mr. Wood and yourself were appointed. And at the last meeting, Mr. Wood brought up the fact that he would like to make another motion to disband the original motion and go immediately to an outside search.
Right.
That was voted down by the entire school board that was here, so we proceeded with the original motion. That's the part of the record. The second part, so then we did advertise internally for candidates. Four candidates presented their applications, and upon analysis of their qualification, one of the candidates was disqualified, didn't have all the qualifications. One of the candidates did not really have 100% of the qualifications. His license for superintendentship was pending, but the board decided that we would interview that individual anyway, which we did. So the three of them came before the board, executive committee, of which all members were allowed to attend and ask questions. So as far as the questions that we asked, these were not from Mike Gilbert. These were typical questions that the MASC, which we are a member of and pay dues every year, presented to us to look over. Of those questions, we chose 14 of them. So
how many questions total were there?
It was probably, my pack was 45 pages.
So you picked 14 of the 45?
Okay. We felt that would be enough within the time span. If you'd like to get a copy of the packet, it was 45 pages of what you're looking for, how to go about it. And this is something that's represented by the MASC, which we are a member of. Then we invited the candidates here. which they all came, and we asked these questions legally or ethically. It's important to ask each candidate the same question, so there's no different interpretations. And at the end, we allow any members that wish to be here to ask a personal question, of which several members did. After that, the executive board unanimously looked over all the candidates. We had an open discussion, and they chose, they had two options. One, they could say, of the three candidates, none of them will be presented to the entire board, or one or two of them. They decided on one. We then, executive board did vote. It was unanimous to bring forth to the entire board for approval. That's a recommendation. That is not take it or leave it. If the entire board decides not to approve the, this particular individual, then the individual is not hired. So it's up to the entire school board. So all the 11 communities are represented by the school committee right here. So, you know, this isn't a fact that you are appointed to act for Whittier also in the best interest of your community. So you, in my mind, are the representative, as Mr. Wood and Mr. Early are represented from Haverhill. Mm-hmm. So they're probably, I'm hoping, are acting in the best interest for Whittier first, because this is where we are, but also for the entire community. So based on that, the executive board tonight is prepared to recommend and to move that Ms. Lynch be appointed superintendent of schools for Whittier Regional Vocational Technical High School, subject to a successful negotiation of a contract of employment mutually agreeable to the candidate and the school committee. That's the motion.
Second.
Based on the protocol of appointing a superintendent, a simple majority of members present on a roll call vote is needed. So just a brief reasoning of why the members of the executive board came forth to bring this one candidate is that mainly for four reasons. All three candidates were well received, had some very good qualifications and some good background. The executive board felt that Ms. Lynch's qualifications were of the highest above the other two, based on her experience and dedication to the school. It's pretty apparent that her heart is here at Whittier. And as everybody knows, and I know personally from being on the board for a while, that we are in one of the best places of all the vocational schools in the state. We have, as you've seen tonight, we have students that are excelling. We have students that come here, as people know, that meet the requirements. Their academic and their vocational skills aren't the best, but within 4 years, they graduate at the top of their class. So it was felt that we want to continue that, to move forward, to keep raising the bar, and we felt that Ms. Lynch would be the best candidate internally and externally to meet those qualifications. So. Now that's, do we have a second for that?
Yes, we do.
Now we're going to have open for discussion, and then we'll have a roll call vote. Anybody wish to comment or to question things? Mr. Tucker.
I wholly endorse the recommendation of the executive committee.
As to why?
Mr. Burns.
I have some reservations.
Yes, sir.
Not that Ms. Lynch isn't qualified. It's just we haven't taken a look at what else is out there. She's an excellent principal. To take her and make her the superintendent now leaves us a vacancy of principal just when school's starting. So I'm not sure that that's the wisest thing to do. So I didn't really want to be put in a position to vote against her, but I really would like to see it opened up.
Well, I think I hear you, the rest of the board hears you. You have to vote your conscience.
Right.
I can't tell you how to vote. I'm just one member, you're a member. Any other comments? Mr. Wood.
Thank you. You already know my feelings. It's nothing personal against the applicant. I'm sure she can, hope that she does a wonderful job. I just believe that the process, I didn't agree with it, so I, you know, I didn't want to have to be in a position either of voting against a candidate, but that's the way that it is. So I just believe that the choice was made before the process began. And that's my personal opinion, and I absolutely believe that firmly.
Is this opinion that, if I may speak, is this an opinion that you've just formulated, or is it a change on a previous opinion?
No, I believe that from the start.
You did, okay, because I have knowledge of several years back that you were a strong proponent of hiring from within if you find the right candidate.
So. I don't think your knowledge is correct on that.
You don't?
No.
Well, I have an article here from a newspaper that somebody gave to me,
mm-hmm.
that stated that in 2011,
mm-hmm.
in the Havel School Committee, which you were a member,
mm-hmm.
You were hiring a candidate, or trying to, by name of Mr. Scully.
I don't know. I'm
and
sure.
There's a quote here from Mr. Velavacqua. It says, "Why do we need to conduct a national search when the man for the job is sitting right here? Other board members, including Mr. Scott Wood, advocated for Scully to be the new permanent superintendent."
Absolutely. After we went out, where all individuals, both inside and outside, were invited to.
Say that.
I don't care what it says. Look at the record. I mean, anybody can hand you what they want. I'm sure it was. So, I'm sure I know who it was. But no, that was actually a direct attack on me, and I will respond to that.
Not a direct attack.
Yeah, it was, because your recollection is absolutely not true. In the record with the city of Haverhill, and I'll bring the minutes, we absolutely went out and we interviewed candidates that were not employees of the city of Haverhill. We had numerous candidates. Some, actually, your former superintendent was a finalist for the position, who was not an employee of the Haverhill Public Schools.
I would like to speak to the motion, if I possibly could, and I don't think that newspaper article is relevant to our current.
But no, that was a direct attack on me, and I was responding to it. That was, because it's not the truth. That's a lie. It's not the truth. We went out. Your former superintendent was a finalist. The Lawrence superintendent was also a semi-finalist for the job. So to say that we kept it internal,
that's a lie. Then
wrong.
I apologize, but
it's wrong.
I just felt that from the beginning, when you entered the school committee, you had already made up your mind.
That, you know what? And as did you.
No, I did not.
Okay. Well, you're going to say that that's
here,
the record.
I've been here for 7 years.
Okay, that's great. But yeah. To say that to say that that's the truth when you don't know the truth, and obviously you don't
know
the truth.
I don't know what somebody gave me, and I don't even know.
Okay,
who gave
to read that and say, though, that that's what I said. I didn't make that comment. I'm not Mr. Bevilacqua. We don't look alike.
I apologize for that, okay? I do.
So, but that's a lie.
I just wanted to get everybody's feelings on the table so we don't, at the end, say it's dirty pool or we didn't do it the right way.
I didn't say it at the end. I said it at the beginning.
Mr. Early.
Up until recently, I was thinking the same way. Let's go out. I believe we have a good candidate inside. I've done a lot of thinking about this. I've talked to a lot of people, but I made my own mind up, and I'm proud of my vote to support her, Miss Lynch. But I'm going to tell you something. It was tough. It really was. Up until recently, I'm not going to get into any of the particulars, but I want to just move this along so we can end it.
Okay. Are there any other comments? Ms. True.
Yeah. I also didn't make up my mind. It took me about 3 weeks, and I spent a lot of time thinking, and a lot of sleepless nights, actually, thinking about this, because I feel like it's so important. I have students here. So I begin to think about what are the things, what are the qualities that are most important. And in an outside external candidate, you can't really assess if someone has honesty and integrity. You can assess whether they're good at, you know, business, or you can assess that they're good at certain aspects of their job. But can you really assess whether they're committed or whether they are honest or have integrity? I don't believe so. I think that you find that out through experience. In my town, we had 10 principals in 15 years. I thought each time they were committed, but they were not. We thought they were, though. I also thought that people would be honest, but sometimes they weren't. In this situation, those are the two biggest. I have other qualifications that I think are important that Maureen has, but those two are the most important. She always keeps the students at the focus, and that's what makes her have integrity. She is honest, and she's committed. 5+ years, that's fabulous, because I haven't seen that yet in 15 years as a parent. Thank you.
Any other comments?
Well said, Joanna.
We'll move. Yes.
Just briefly, we have an eminently qualified candidate in-house. She knows the culture. She's part of the culture. You bring someone in outside, it may be fine, but you don't know for sure. And to echo the words we just heard, it costs us $20,000 at least to go outside. It would delay it into next year, another year for a superintendent to get his or her feet wet. And, you know, if we weren't really sure to bring it forth to this board, that we would have opened it up wider. But we are really, really sure that we have an outstanding candidate, and we don't really want to lose her either.
Yes, Mr.
Just a point, I guess.
Yes, sir.
Being new to this board, I don't know who all the players are, but in my other situation, I would know who represents the teachers and the teachers union, and I would have a feel of how well this position, this person, this position would, is received, whether they feel they're competent or not. Can anybody enlighten me on how the teachers representative here feels about Mrs. Lynch and her job with this district? Meaning, is there friction between the teachers and the principal, or is there not?
None. I have a possible enlightenment.
Mr. Tucker.
Don't we have in our packet a move to ratify the contract?
What's that to do with?
Well, it has everything. Administration and the teachers have signed a tentative contract to bring to us. I mean,
the reason I bring this point is we had a superintendent in place and we had a vote of no confidence with him. Right now, it's completely the opposite. They absolutely support the superintendent as well as he supports the teachers. I'd like to just ask out here, who can enlighten me with that?
Sterling.
Check her evaluation.
Doug, I've been on the board now 15 to 16 or 17 years, but I've been involved with the school since 1989, 90, and I had a son graduate in 91. I'm around here a lot, but recently I haven't been. But I see Miss Lynch everywhere. When it comes to walking around the corridors, and I come down at all different times. I see her at a lot of functions. I see her at baseball or basketball games. More importantly, I see her around the kids. I have to tell you, we have a boosters club here, which support all the, and I'm just giving them an update of what I see over these years. She's involved with the boosters club. I was involved with them up until 4 or 5 years ago. It really wasn't a good thing. I was still on it. But I chose to help them and help them and help them. Financially, they're in good shape back then. If it wasn't for this young lady keeping this thing going, we'd have nobody. Okay. She actually goes to the monthly meeting. Is it on Wednesday night or Thursday night? Thursday night. I didn't know what night it was. But I'm going to be honest with you. I told you up until recently I made this decision, but I've got a big picture of this whole thing, and I put it all together. I put the whole puzzle together myself. Didn't listen to anybody, but I'm going to tell you, she's visible. She's everywhere around the school that I see, and I've been around here a long time. I just wanted to get you clarified on that, but most importantly, the kids are around. She's around the kids. I'm going to leave it there.
Yes, Ms. Testaverde.
I'd like to make two comments. First of all, in regard to a national search, Massachusetts has a very distinct patent for vocational education. We are one of the few states who have high school vocational education. The majority, the vast majority, probably 45 out of 50 states, if that, if not more, have only vocational education at the college level, community college level. So our programs are very different. Opening to a national search, you could have possibly have been getting people who really don't understand Massachusetts vocational technical education. Secondly, Maureen has been on the leadership team as long as Bill has been with us. Where we have come over the past years to have be a number one school, to be a first quality school, the amount of our graduation status, our MCAS passing levels, the where we place students in the 90, above 90 percentile of the people going into the military, our graduates are all placed. Very few do not have somewhere that they are going that we are not proud of. And that has to do with strong leadership, cooperation, and an understanding of our system. And I don't think there is anybody in the school that qualifies or has that kind of knowledge as well as Maureen Lynch.
I think we cheated Ms. Lynch by not opening up the whole thing to outside to let her shine the way she would have shined against a larger audience, and it would have answered these questions. I, for one, would have liked to have seen a more open search, but I have no doubt that she would have shown herself extremely well in that. So I'm sorry we didn't give you that opportunity. I think you would have done well with it.
Thank you. Any other?
I'd just like to respond to Doug.
Yes.
Member Galina, you asked about her relationship with the teachers. And
yes, that's really the most important one to me.
Yeah, and I just
right
wanted
now
to respond to that because I don't think anyone quite has responded specifically to that. My students go here, so I've been attending parent meetings and events here, and I have had the opportunity to see Ms. Lynch interact with her staff, her faculty, and I can see that there is mutual respect between them. I see it every single time, and I know the difference because I haven't seen that at my old district where my children went years ago. I have seen the difference in whatever it is, the way that you're, you know, the way they speak to each other, the body language, and all of that. I see it, and I see the mutual respect that they have for each other. She respects them, they respect her. They know that she has their best interest, that she provides them with excellent leadership and professional development, the highest level.
Very good. Thank you. I appreciate the information.
Any final questions or comments? Okay. And the roll call vote, please vote yes or no. Mr. Early?
Yes.
Mr. Wood?
No.
Mr. Galina?
Yes.
Yes. Ms.
Yes.
Gilbert? Mr. Tucker?
Yay.
Chair votes yes. Mr. Murphy?
Yes.
Mr. Irving?
Aye.
Ms. Testaverde?
Yes.
Mr. Brown?
Aye.
It's true.
Yes, the chair doesn't have to.
No.
I know. No. Mr. Lesage?
Yes.
Final vote?
Mm-hmm.
11 yes, 2 no. 11 yes, 2 no. The congratulations.
Having voted in the negative,
yes, sir.
I'm asking for reconsideration.
Second.
So that we can make it unanimous.
Second. Second?
Yep.
Yes.
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 Yes. Chair votes yes.
Yes.
Aye. Mr. Irving.
Yes.
Yes.
Aye.
Yes. Mr. Schultz.
Yes.
Yes.
It is unanimous.
That's the reconsideration. I do
to
have
make
to.
Unanimous.
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank
congratulations.
You.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Really want to say thank you. You know, I have a lot of love for the school. I have, you know, great respect for the students and the staff. I really want to say thank you to Mr. DeRosa and his retirement. You know, I'm going to miss him terribly, but I'm looking forward to starting in my new role. So thank you. I look forward to working with you.
May I just, Maureen, I just would like to say
that I don't need you to shine for anybody else. You shine so brightly here that we are very grateful and very glad to have you.
Oh, thank you. That was very nice.
Thanks, Maureen.
Thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman?
Yes. Mr. Irving,
I'm
yes.
I'm still looking for votes. We moved at the executive committee. I moved it. Mr.
Yes.
Murphy seconded the fact of receiving the letter of resignation from Superintendent DeRosa. Regret, so I would move that forward for the full committee.
Second?
Second.
Any comments on his resignation? None being heard? All in favor, please say aye.
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 Oh, you, excuse me.
Well, I was just going to say, when's the last day? When do you drive
August
out the 11th. Parking lot forever?
August 11th.
August
11th. All right.
Thank you.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
With regret.
Okay.
Thank you.
Now moving on back to the regular agenda, the superintendent's report.
Mr. Chairman, before I do my next to last report.
Oh, excuse me.
If you want it to be my last, that's fine. I'd like to introduce the student rep that's replacing Connor. I'd like her to come up to the podium for a minute. And Connor, why don't you introduce her?
Should have done this half an hour ago.
So the new student representative replacing my spot will be Saffron Fox. She's a junior here at Whittier.
Welcome.
Hi.
Welcome. What area are you in?
I'm taking HVAC. Oh. So heating and ventilation.
Where are you from?
I live in Amesbury.
You come to the
I didn't know that. You know?
No.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
Thank
look
you.
Forward welcome. To working with you in the future.
All right, thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Big shoes.
Okay.
Superintendent.
Mr. Chairman, for informational purposes, in your packet tonight, I have some information on hires, a mathematics instructor, grade 11 SAT prep after school program, grade 10 math MCAS after school program, history-based teacher shared website, and evening school. Also included in your packet is notice of resignations for purposes of retirement. I'm just getting to my update. In terms,
Mr. Superintendent, through the chair, what, the history-based teacher shared is website type thing?
They're designing websites for students to access.
In-house, or are they going outside to bring
in-house.
Together? But they've got to gather outside material, or
yes.
No?
Yes, they're designing it. They're actually working on the design.
Thank you.
Okay. Next, in terms of a budget update.
Yes, sir.
The communities of Groveland, Merrimack, West Newberry, Rowley, and Ipswich have all voted affirmative on the budget. I'd like to thank the communities for their continued support, and I would especially like to thank the town of Ipswich for their complimentary words last night regarding Whittier Tech from both their school committee and boards of selectmen. The town of Georgetown voted in the affirmative, however, the figure was incorrect. And because the figure was incorrect, it does not count as a yes vote. It was a mistake on their part, an error from the figure that we sent them. On Thursday, we're presenting to the Amesbury Finance Committee, and next week we're scheduled for Salisbury on Monday, May 18th, and Newberry on Tuesday, May 19th. In terms of an MCAS update, Whittier is currently offering a free MCAS after school program, and over 100 students are enrolled. The math MCAS exam will be administered on May 19 and 20. In terms of my regular update, on Wednesday, April 15, I attended the North Shore Superintendent's Roundtable Luncheon. There was a presentation from Catherine Craven. If you remember, she was our graduation speaker my first year as superintendent. At that time, she was the head of the executive director of Mass School Building Authority. She now sits on the Board of Education, and she came to do a presentation. On Monday, the 27th, I attended the Georgetown town meeting. On Thursday, April 30th, Whittier hosted the annual advisory board dinner. I'd like to especially thank Beverly DeSalvo, our vocational technical coordinator, and our culinary staff for an incredible evening, as well as thanking members of the advisory board who give freely of their time to help guide Whittier toward the future. And I would also like to thank Suzanne Bump publicly, the state auditor, who was our guest speaker. On Monday, May 4, I attended the Georgetown meeting, but as I mentioned, that does not count as one of our affirmative votes because of the figure. On Thursday, May 7th, I attended a luncheon with Tom Mortimer from Haverhill Bank. I thank Tom for Haverhill's continued support of Whittier. As you know, they have a branch here at Whittier, and they're also very generous with scholarship money and other donations to the school throughout the school year, and I would like for that to continue. On Friday, May 8th, I hosted a budget breakfast for Haverhill City Council. In attendance was Mr. Mitchison, President of the City Council. We reviewed the budget, discussed programming at Whittier, and I'd like to thank John for taking the time to meet with us. This past Monday, I attended a breakfast with Bruce Tarr, and at that time, we talked about Chapter 70 funding. As you know, he is a state senator, and we talked about Chapter 70 funding. Next, Mr. Chairman, is the acceptance of a donation. As you know, according to school committee policy, I need permission of the school committee to accept a donation. The family of Travis Yell is donating a tree to plant in the school in memory of Travis. I respectfully request the school committee's approval for acceptance of this donation.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
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 All opposed? Unanimous.
Do you know where they're going to put it?
Out front. It's going to be someplace out front in near the foyer. Next, Mr. Chairman, I have a couple of school field trips I need approved. One field trip, because it's an out-of-state, they're going to New Hampshire. You approved one of their field trips last month. This is the other week's students that are going. They're going to Wilcox Industries in Newington, New Hampshire, and because it's out-of-state, I need a vote of the committee.
So moved.
Second.
Any questions?
Just early? A day trip.
Yes, correct? Do we have the right paperwork?
Yes, we do.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous.
Next, Mr. Chairman, I need another school committee field trip approval for two reasons. One, because it's out of state. Two, because it's overnight. This is for our gold medal winner to attend Skills USA in Louisville, Kentucky. And they will be supervised by two staff members. This is from the 22nd to the 27th of June. So I need school committee approval.
So moved.
Second.
Is this one student going?
Yes.
The gold medals.
Correct.
Mr. Early.
We have the right paperwork for that?
Yes.
Family?
Yes, we do.
Are the parents going with them too?
If they do, it would be at their expense. Most times parents do attend when they can.
Okay. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Unanimous.
That's it for my report, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, sir. The principal report.
Let's see that.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. In your packet was a draft of the school calendar for next year. Are there any questions?
Any questions on this list?
Okay.
I got a question.
Yes.
All the students are coming in for one day and then they don't come back for the next week?
All the students will come in. It's small print now, and I need the glasses.
Wednesday and Thursday.
All freshman students show up on September 1st.
Right.
And then September 2nd and 3rd, all students come to school. And then the 4th, there's a no school day. That's the Friday.
Oh, okay. Well, it doesn't say September 3rd here.
No, it doesn't list it. She lists openings and closings. So September 3rd is just a regular day.
Oh, I see. Okay. I'm sorry. I apologize.
That's okay.
Is there a motion on the floor to accept the calendar?
So moved.
Moved by Ms. Lossage.
Second
by Dr. Testaverde. Yeah. Any more questions on the, and that's the 180 days and all that. Yep. All in favor, please say aye.
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 You're new.
I have a question.
Oops, go ahead.
Ms. Lynch, when's the last day of school this year?
June 22nd.
Oh, so it's the same. How many extra snow days.
We had seven snow days.
Seven?
Mm-hmm.
And we have five on this calendar, is that
right?
Correct? Thank you.
Yeah, we meet the required 180 school days plus the 990-hour requirement that's required of secondary high schools.
Thanks.
Okay.
So, Mike, somebody told me that legally in Mass, you can't go to school after June 30.
July 30.
It has to be done
before
the next
before
fiscal
July
year.
1st.
Yeah.
Fiscal year, you have to get done, otherwise you go Saturdays and after school.
Right, okay. Yeah. No, I never heard of that.
The idea is 990 hours.
Fiscal
or
year.
The other
fiscal year changes.
All right. Anything else, Ms. Lynch?
Yes, can I give a quick update?
Yep.
Would that be okay? This is a very busy time of the year. Yeah. I first would like to invite all of you to Honors Night, which will be held on May 20th at 7 o'clock here in the auditorium. We'll be honoring students for many reasons, including new inductees to the National Vocational Technical Honor Society. Students will get their CNA pins, and also students with perfect attendance and high honors for all four quarters. It's a great night for both students and faculty, so you know, we have some light refreshments, so please feel free to attend that event.
What time is that?
7 o'clock.
7 p.m.
Yep. On Wednesday night?
Yes.
Yeah.
We've been very lucky to have a wonderful senior class this year. Connor's left. He has obviously done very well. We look forward to many senior activities that include, when you talk about our school resource officer, we're doing a mock car crash. Our school resource officer, Officer Landry, with the help of faculty and staff in the Haverhill Police and Fire Departments, will put on a presentation regarding teenagers being under the influence of drugs and alcohol, as well as text messaging, and getting behind the wheel of a car. And this is scheduled for May 21st in the afternoon. That's Thursday, May 21st. And then on Friday, our senior talent show, which is always a fun event. The kids look forward to it for 4 years, they tell me, because 1 year I thought about canceling, and I was told it's tradition. So we look forward to that on May 22nd. And then on May 26th, our seniors will be signing out, and the prom is scheduled for May 26th at Atkinson Country Club. And then, of course, graduation on May 28th at 6 p.m. for the class of 2015. And that's all I have for you tonight.
Any questions for Ms. Lynch?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Kahn.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, Superintendent DeRosa. I have a couple of things. In your packet, you will see the results of the diesel fuel oil bid. This is one of the things that we put out every year for bid. It is also one of the bids that we typically only get one response for, and that is Edgemont Oil is the successful and only bidder. Don Martin from Transportation, Tammy Dentermont, the comptroller, and I were present when we opened the bids. And the bid is the Boston Daily price plus 19 cents plus state tax. So it's up 2 cents more than it is this year. So it seems in line. And we did go up a little bit in the budget anticipating that fuel would be up. So we like to keep you informed about all of the bids. And so that's the one for the fuel oil. And I'll be coming back to you next month with things like the school supplies, and we're also doing some of the things that were in the budget, the two buses and all of that. So those will be updated as they come in. I'm sorry
I interrupt you, but why were they sent two on the back? They're listed twice.
We two people requested the documents on the back of, you get who requested it. They don't always respond. So we will often have times, we put things, what we do is we advertise on goods and services with the Inspector General's office at the state. Mm-hmm. We advertise in the Eagle Tribune, and we give them the information. We also put it up as a link on our website. So there are three ways that people can get the notifications of our bids. A lot of people request bid documents, but oftentimes don't return the bid documentation either. They don't meet the specifications, they're too far away. I don't know what the reason is, but that happens a lot.
Okay. No, I was just wondering why Edgemont was there twice.
Oh, I don't know. I'm sorry. I have no idea.
An LLC in one.
Oh.
They have two different names.
You're right. Yeah.
Oh. An LLC and one's a corporation.
You're right.
Yeah, I don't know why they did. Maybe two different people in the company grabbed the bid.
Well,
yeah.
Two different companies.
Okay, thank you.
I'd also like to bring you up to date on something that happened in the building. I'm sorry.
Question. It's showing my ignorance, but who's Tammy?
Who's what?
Oh, that's they only know people by their last name.
We'll put name tags on.
I got it now. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Okay, I wanted to bring you up to date over something that happened with the metal part of the school roof. On Monday, April 13th, Harry Takesian, our director of maintenance, arrived here at school, and he discovered that roughly 300 feet of metal roof had separated from the building. The area involved is the length of the building that is to my rear, behind the bank, behind the school store, several classrooms. Our insurance agent immediately was dispatched. He dispatched an adjuster to assess the damage, and it was evident to all that the roof had failed as a result of multiple ice dams that had accumulated during the extremely cold winter, coupled with the high winds that had occurred over that past weekend. The metal roofs on this building are original to the building. They were not included in the repair that was done in 2010. They are included as part of the statement of interest. We address that as something that does need to be repaired. Of the three contractors that we called for evaluation and cost estimates, only one responded and determined that the damaged sections were beyond repair. The initial estimate was $137,000, and we provided this to the insurance company. However, upon further inspection, the contractor soon discovered that all of the insulated materials had disintegrated because they're 42 years old, and a more extensive repair would be necessary to ensure that we'd be code compliant and have a watertight roofing system. So the updated estimate was $233,000. Due to the immediate need to protect the health and safety of students and staff, the work had to commence immediately, and therefore I did submit a request to the State's Division of Capital Asset Maintenance and Management, and they did approve it because we had to circumvent the 30B bidding requirements because we needed to do it right away. I would like to thank Mr. Dekesian and his staff for their proactive response as soon as he found out what was going on, and because of their ongoing efforts to keep everyone safe and the building protected from any further damage from the elements, there were no instructional interruptions during the entire repair process. While we are very lucky that most, if not all, of this repair will be covered under our insurance policy, it clearly illustrates the need for Whittier to maintain a healthy excess and deficiency balance. Had this not been covered by our insurance, we would have had no choice but to use funds from E&D to cover the cost, as our operating budget could never have withstood the expenditure of over $250,000 at this time of the fiscal year. In the event our E&D did not have a healthy balance and did not have sufficient funds to cover such a cost, we would have then had no option but to go back to the member communities and request an additional assessment. So I just wanted to tell you about the insurance claim that we have, the fact that we do have other systems in this building which are over 40 years old, and that is why it is so important that we maintain a healthy balance in our excess and deficiency, and we do that. Are there any questions?
Well, is there a deductible on that?
The deductible is $5,000. And again, I have not heard back from the underwriter. There may be some residuals that we have to pay for. It's going in against what the code compliance is with the city building inspector. It would be minimal based on the 233, but we definitely will have to pay the $5,000 deductible.
Who was the contractor?
My goodness. The contractor is the one, Greenwood Industries, they did the original roof. So they were very familiar with the structure of the building. And I have to say, they were out here within 4 hours to inspect.
Excellent.
Wow.
Oh, I should say reports. Okay. Any questions?
Any good questions for the business manager?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And now move on to the committee chairs. The first is the appointment under the chairperson of subcommittees. You know that, my dear?
Mm-hmm.
What I did is I went through the subcommittees that are present, and I realigned some people to get some of the new members involved in the committee. So I'm going to hand these out now. And please take a look at which committees you're on, and if you feel you don't want to be on that, or you want to be on a different one, you know, let me know. But I try to put everybody on at least one committee. I think it's important that, you know, little by little, we all try to use our expertise in these committees. So I hope I didn't put, because you know there are five committees. There's instructional, plan operations, salary, here's some money. I'm sorry. And the executive. And for all those,
I know.
The chair, the vice chair, and the treasurer are on the executive board. Once these committees meet, is you enough over there?
We need one more.
Once these committees meet, they will reorganize nominate of their own committee, pick a chairperson, and then that person is automatically a member of the executive committee. So.
Thank you very much. My appointment is well accepted.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. I try to put what I know about people, expertise and knowledge, and where they would like to be. Thank you. As I said, okie doke. Okay. School calendar, we just were on that. June annual agenda items, policy updates, and we'll vote on a representative and alternate to the MCAS, MASS joint conference. It's usually the first week in November down at the Cape. And all members are invited to go. They don't have to be the rep or the alternate. Mm-hmm. It's very very informational, and I think, I don't know if Mr. Wood or Mr. Glenn, they have to go to the, or they already?
No, they must already have gone to training because they're on board. Yeah.
What, for new school committee members?
Yeah.
Yeah, 12 years ago.
Oh, you're all set. Yeah. You did yours for Pentucket, so you're all set.
Yeah.
Is the instruction personnel. Dr. Testaverde.
At this time, we have not had a meeting, and I spoke with the superintendent this afternoon, and there is not a need for a meeting for this year, but we will be looking forward to a meeting in probably at the October meeting, get school started, look at where we're at. We have no need at this time for textbooks or other issues that will be brought forward.
Right. We have the minutes of the executive committee to approve. A motion.
Move that.
Packet.
Move
them. Second by Mr. Hubert. Yeah. Any omissions, deletions, or corrections? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. I'm saying no, I wasn't there. I wasn't there, so.
And you would abstain.
Yeah, yeah, I'll abstain.
Mr. Wood, abstain. Plan operations, Mr. Murphy.
We have not met, but I believe we need to set up a meeting to go over summer projects.
Yes.
Summer projects. Want to set that up now, or you want to wait till the next meeting?
We got to involve Mr. Tarkisian, so.
Yeah, so before the June meeting.
Yeah.
That'd be good.
Okay.
6 o'clock.
Whatever.
You need that? Need an hour?
Yeah. That'll give us time.
Just notify all the members to make sure they can make it. Okay. Policy, Mr. Irving.
Yeah, we have not met, but I'd like to have a brief meeting. Anybody on that committee? Hopefully, like 10 minutes off or something. I just want to check with the superintendent, make sure nothing comes in prior to the summer recess, and also to reorganize.
Okay.
So,
we'll make that, you know, 6:40 meeting.
Yeah, 6:45. Okay. If anybody's on the other committee that's just meeting, we can kind of slide in before. We don't need much time.
Yeah. And the school building committee,
that's
wastewater.
That's the ones that were in our packet tonight.
Yeah. Is that that defunct now? We're all clear.
No. Those.
No?
No.
What is this?
Those are existing policies. Those are
existing policies.
Those aren't new.
Oh.
Just a reference.
We're going to do that in executive session.
Yeah. Yes.
We need to approve the minutes from executive, from, what do you call it, salary negotiations.
Where were those?
They were
before. Oh, excuse me. Yeah. In your packet were the minutes from the salary negotiations, 2015, April 14th. Is there a motion on the floor to approve those?
Motion to approve.
Motion, second. Any question? Well, we're going to go over those in an executive session. So, okay. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? And now we have the school building committee wastewater. Is that
no need to meet? We're done.
We're closed out. Everything's done.
Right.
We can remove that from the agenda.
Yes.
Meeting dates. Regular school committee meeting is on June the 10th, 2015. Next month. At that meeting, we will be discussing the summer meetings.
You have the subcommittees at night.
Yeah.
6:45, you said?
Yeah. 6:45 for policy.
Under new business, We have something brought up the last meeting. I told him I'd put it on this month's agenda on emailing the representatives. Yes, sir.
Okay, there's a couple of things. Emailing is a practice that Pawtucket does for everything that can be emailed versus mailed to save on stamps, envelopes, time, and money. And what happens is the clerk for the school committee will email you to whichever email address you choose. We have one at the school. I don't use mine at school. I use my personal one, so it's all wrapped up. So I get all my emails from the business manager to the superintendent to the clerk. Any questions and vice versa, it's all done through emails. But any agendas comes in a form of an email. Everything saves the cost of a stamp, cost of a person standing behind a copying machine, the cost of the paper. It's just good. It's good business sense to do this. So I was really surprised that they're not doing it here. So I brought it up to see what other people would think about this.
I personally think it's a good idea. I don't think if somebody wishes not to have it done, we would continue to send it at the normal way. But for those that would like it, I think it would be a great thing. I'd rather get mine by the email. Any other comments? Mr. Tucker?
Well, I'm perfectly open to receiving emails for information, but I still like that. I like to have a packet that comes a few days before the meeting so I can digest it. The packet.
I wouldn't
stuff.
Want to get all of this stuff in my email.
No, well, what they do, it's, you know, everybody does it different. That's why I'm putting this out here. Mm-hmm. So we can discuss it. What they do is the packet is online, and they email you a link that you could click on if you wanted to. Now, it's got a good point what he brings up. Everybody at Pawtucket is issued a tablet computer. And they do all, when you see them at the school committee, most of them have their tablets in front of them. A couple choose not to use them. The point that he brought up is good. At the meeting, I request a hard copy of the agenda. I like to have that with my pet. It's just my own personal preference. There's a few others that do it, so the clerk will make that available. But I get...
So that's not saving on...
That, no, that particular one, but not having to print it out for everybody at the committee, the and not having the postage and to put it in an envelope and all the time and energy. But there are, I want to say, three people that request a package the day of the meeting. Everybody reads the packet online at their convenience. It's posted in time so they can go on. They're provided with a tablet, which, again, that's the way they chose to do it. The only thing I was bringing up tonight is, you know, all these correspondence of when the meetings are and when the meetings change and this and that. There's 15 of us. By the time you put a stamp and an envelope and a man who's charging it, there's a cost to this. Where someone just hits, okay, send. Yes. He's having a
I have a question.
Go ahead.
So you don't, I would just want to understand it correctly.
Sure.
You don't necessarily download the whole packet like at your home or anything because you have a tablet.
You use the
tablet at the meeting, is that right?
Right, and that was brought up when they initially went to the tablet. It was made, the committee was made aware of that in the case of a lawsuit, they may subpoena your cell phones or your personal computers. So they decided rather than put anybody through that, they were going to issue tablets. And that way, if it ever came to that, they're taking school property, not your property.
I like that idea.
And it made a lot of people feel good. At the time, they were spending $10,000 a month on attorney fees. We spend $200 a month right now on attorney fees. We have the right superintendent in place. Just for discussion, see what you think about it.
The money we save by not having a search,
no,
we could get tablets.
I like the idea.
We were at a point where lawsuits were prevalent. People got nervous. They didn't want to have their computer taken with all their bank and finance. And
all right,
so the tablet discussion came forward. Mm-hmm. Then we said, well, if we're going to use tablets, why the heck are we using all these papers? And so it's virtually a paperless society. The only difference is on the day of the meeting, I'm just old-fashioned. I like to scratch it off, and everybody else is doing it. I bring my tablet, but I do have one copy. But and since I've been on this committee, I think I've received 15 letters. So that means everybody in this room has gotten those same 15 letters. You know, it's the cost. I'm just trying to save the school some money. That's all.
I'm in favor of it. I think, but those that don't wish to do that, I think have also have the right to have the traditional. But I would rather get everything on, and I'll just print it out at home when I want.
Well, we're talking about two different things.
But the point that was brought up by Doug is that now your home email is subpoenaable.
Oh, it is.
Yeah.
Yes, it is.
And that wouldn't be a very good idea.
No.
That's what you want. I wouldn't want that going to my home. If a school wants to supply me with a tablet, that's fine for my emails, but I wouldn't subject my home computer to emails.
Right. Well, you're right. What about if we say we started with just getting the meeting announcements?
Still public record.
Yeah. Still public record.
They didn't come in.
All right.
So if we had tablets, we would have a school email address.
Yeah, that's the way they do it. Yeah. You would have a school email address. You'd have a school tablet. All correspondence.
And you don't use it for anything else.
Encouraged to do it through the tablet.
Yeah. Job.
And, you know, the tablet's on loan. It's assigned to you. It's got a serial number. And
why don't we do this? Why don't we see how much that would cost and see how much we would save in labor and paper?
Next superintendent.
Well, you know, you're buying so many iPads for the kids. It's the same story.
Right, just like the children.
So
yeah, they're just like buying for the kids.
If labor can save 70%, it's great.
So why don't we do that? Everybody agreeable to that?
I agree.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll do a little.
What about those of us who would still like to receive? Only because
I'm saying,
I have to tell you, with my current job of babysitting two small children, I very rarely get on my computer and check my emails. Well, I'll get on, and I've had emails from 2 months ago. They're at the computer.
I
can't do it.
Right, as I said, if you wish to remain the way you had it, we can still do that.
I like to feel in touch.
Yeah, well, then that's your prerogative. We're not going to force you to say you got to do it this way.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, like I said, if we get an email of a meeting that we all know when it's coming, or maybe a postponement of it, I'd rather just get an email, look at it, schedule it. My calendar's on it.
Right.
Schedule my calendar. It's done.
We'll see how much the investment is and take a look for the savings. Just roughly, how many people here would still want to get the paper trail? One, two.
Maybe the agenda just to check off.
The packet.
The other stuff.
I'm interested in most, but that's it.
Yeah.
Well, they used to. So probably three or four. So we can factor that into the equation.
Well, why don't you check it out and then come back and keep an ongoing discussion?
Yeah. No, we're going to check it out. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, we're going to check it out. We are buying some. We are buying some iPads, aren't we?
We lease. We don't buy. We lease.
Yeah, yeah. Well, same thing.
Yeah.
Yes, Mr. Tucker.
Just to offer some history to Doug, a number of years ago, probably 10 or 15 years ago, every member of the Lawrence School Committee got a brand new laptop, and that was a huge controversy at the time. So ever since then, I think most school committees in Massachusetts are gun-shy. Enough time has passed, so maybe now the time is right.
They're successful.
But you may recall, that was huge. That was huge.
It was huge.
Yeah, it was. That was 10 years ago.
The freshmen and sophomores have started with the iPads. We're setting a standard. We are setting up. Teachers are coming up with ways to utilize. We should be setting examples, saying, you're right, we're in the modern age.
Yeah.
Here it is. It's the cost, but it's also a convenience thing. And it would make things a lot easier for a number of people.
Yeah.
It sets the right trend for the school.
And we don't own them, it's the schools.
Right, right, it's the schools.
Absolutely right.
The
absolutely
only
right
thing that would be on it is stuff related.
Whittier.
Would be Whittier stuff. Okay, yeah. I could probably handle
you
that.
Like the student?
Yeah.
Don't have school stuff on there.
I think Dick
Tony,
too.
You've seen those kids.
I know, I have.
Okay.
I also would be done with
I have to talk about the role of the clerk for the school.
Yes. Go ahead.
Okay. I sent an email out to the clerk.
Guys, Mr. Burns, please.
This kid, he hasn't finished yet.
This is another subject. I sent an email out to the clerk requesting an email address. What I got back, I was kind of surprised with, it was a letter requesting all correspondences to go through the superintendent. Now, I can only go by what my history is. I don't know what your history is. But the school committee, and as I'm told, hires or pays a stipend to have a clerk or a secretary, so we can reach out to that person for information as we need it. Now, if I'm not right, please correct me, but I found it difficult that the superintendent has to have his day interrupted just so I could get the business manager's email address. I thought it was, you know, it didn't need to go there. Just, well, now, am I wrong?
Protocol at Whittier, and obviously my experience at most schools is that the administrators, including the business manager, even though we hire and fire, report to the superintendent. And any information that anybody would want is available, but the protocol is either go through the superintendent or through the chair. And I don't know of any case where anything was denied.
Well, I'm not asking the superintendent, secretary, or administrative assistant to give me something. I'm asking the school committee's administrative assistant to give me something. And I am a school committee member. And right, I feel as a checks and balances.
Right.
I have some rights as a school committee member.
Right.
And I don't feel that I need to bother or care to talk to the superintendent for every little question I may have. I get questions from the politicians in town. Mm-hmm. I get questions from parents in town. And I try to diffuse these as easy as I can without bothering everybody in the line, including yourself, Chuck. I could send a letter to you. You could send a letter to her. She could send a letter to him. It could all come down. I don't feel it needs to. I don't think it has to. In our community, we have an open transparency system, and if I have a budgetary question, which I'll bring up next, if I have a budgetary question, I literally email the business manager. He gets me the information, sends it back. That's it. I could take care of whoever has a question. A month ago, I talked to the business manager, and I asked her some questions. I said, I'm being asked about providing transportation for school of choice. People in my town, my community, don't feel we have the right to do that. They feel it's illegal. And I said, so what I'm asking you is just please provide me with something in writing that says it's legal. I said, I'm being challenged on the meals we're putting out. Since I've been part of this district, I know of 500 meals that have been served here. The money that comes to the school is for education. It's for teachers, it's for the students. It's not to be throwing these meals. This is the way it's explained to me. And my explanation, I don't think I was forceful or rude in every way. I said, please, just give me something that I could take back to them and say, look, this is where they feel they're in the right. If you don't accept it, take it to the next level, we will. That's all. And I didn't receive nothing in over 30 days. Now, most of you know, tomorrow there's a meeting in West Newbury. They're bringing all the selectmen, the business managers, and the public from all three communities. Their questions, what did I ask? I asked about, what is the rationale for paying the transportation cost of student choice? If I had answers to these questions, this meeting would not have taken place. I'm be attending this meeting, and I wish some of you will. I certainly hope Mr. Mansfield, and I certainly hope you will, from Merrimack. This is gonna be an ugly time. It's gonna be an ugly meeting. And all I asked was for transparency, some simple information to say, this is where they feel they're in the right. It looks, I can put my opinion to it, one way or the other. Chances are that's as far as it would have gone. But it didn't. I didn't get my information because the superintendent takes a guardian position over this committee and over this school. We don't, other districts don't share that way. We have an open door policy. We're allowed to ask questions. I'm not asking names. I don't want to ask, I'm not going to say this teacher or that person or this student. What is the budget for this line item? Can you show me that? Can you explain to that to me? They want to know why this is being done. Answer the person that's asking me the question. It goes away. But when people are being told they can't have these answers, this is the result. It's ugly. This is the way Pawtucket used to be. It was ugly. We don't operate this way anymore. We have a full support of the towns, the community, and the teachers. And I think going forward with the new superintendent, I hope she's more in tune to the transparency, the open door policy. So if you have a question with your tablet, you can shoot off that email and get a simple answer or get a simple email and not be shut down because this gentleman wants to run the whole show. I don't support that. I wouldn't support that. He works for me, he works for you.
I'm just taken back completely. I was on the Georgetown School Committee for 9 years.
Yes.
I've been on the Whittier School Committee for 12 years.
Yes.
I have never once ever heard anyone say that Whittier has in any way hidden information. As far as the budget goes, we go through hours and hours and hours of public discussions. Bill goes to every town. We follow every single legal.
Perhaps I misspoke. What I'm saying is when I asked a question, I'm sure you have questions too. I think at some point you just want to ask a basic question. Please send me this email. It doesn't have to go that far. That's people putting the fence up. That's people saying, I don't want to talk to you. That's all that is. I understand about the budget. I know how hard these are. I've been on a school committee myself. I know what, before this, I know what it's all about. And transparency is the best policy. It's their money. They want to know where it's going.
I think I answered you in regard to their money. You keep saying it's their money. They want to know where it's going. Yes, it is all public documents. And I have never once ever called the superintendent in my 11 years on this committee and ever not had a question answered or not been had an open door to go in and speak with
him. Well, then this committee's different because when I send a letter to the secretary of the school committee, I would like her to send an email with a phone number or answer to a question. I don't feel I need to go to the superintendent, but if the committee here is going to support this behavior, I don't see it changing.
Why should Mr. Galino, we are. I'm just overwhelmed because as far as Whittier has gone, we are considered one of the most top-notch vocational schools in the state. We're within the top five and even the top three.
Well,
and
I'm hoping that's true. I would invite you to come to the meeting tomorrow night and see what three towns have to say about this school. I hope what you say is true.
Three towns.
Mr. Murphy.
I'm just trying to get you people to open up and see what other people see this as. And
some
all they want is some information to say, this is. They got questions. They want to know if you're spending the money right. If I had a piece of paper to show them, this never would have happened. This meeting never would have happened.
Yeah, I did.
Mr. Toledo.
Yes, sir.
There's 11 towns and 14 members here.
Right.
If we all went to the secretary, the business manager, or who else, it would be out of control.
Chaos.
Without going through the superintendent.
I disagree.
Excuse me. And he would be left out of the loop. So if someone else, one of the people that you're trying to respond to, called him, he would have no idea what was going on. And he would be, you know, you would and he wouldn't.
Come to the meeting and enjoy what we're going to go through then. And that's all I can say.
I've been on this committee for...
At the very least.
13 years, and I've never had a problem.
The council come to me and said, the superintendent would like to speak to you about this. Okay, yes, all right. Yeah, we're going to give some... Nothing came my way in 30 days. Nothing.
I've been here for 13 years, and I've had a lot of questions, and I go, sometimes I get directly through to Bill. If he's out of the office or in a meeting, he replies back to me. He calls me back, you know, as soon as possible to give me the answer. I wouldn't even think about going around him, only because, like I said, this...
I'm going around him for an email address?
I don't know.
That's a stretch, sir.
I don't know.
That's a stretch.
What's in the email?
What's an email? I just asked for an email address.
Well, you obviously want to put something in the email to go to somebody.
That's leading to something else.
I asked for the email address to the business manager. I wanted a follow-up if she had any information so I could talk to these people.
And the stuff on the website?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yes, well, I'll need it back, though.
The other question here is,
of course you may.
Why aren't they asking us for this information? Why are they having a meeting amongst themselves when they should be coming to us if they have questions?
Well, the selectmen started this. You would have to talk with them.
Well, I will.
The selectmen invited us to their campus. Yeah. This is not something we started. This is the selectmen. They reached out to other selectmen, and they have questions. Can I sit back for 1 minute? Their agenda basically reads that every town is going to have 2 minutes to speak. This is their concerns, and this is what I was hoping to diffuse. Right. Consider an open or revised admission policy for in-district students. That's one of the... There's three towns. You can say one town.
I understand. There's three towns.
This brings clout. Consider not accepting choice in students in... Let me read that right. Consider not accepting choice in students in future years. Right? What is the rationale for paying the transportation costs for choice students? I've got an answer for this.
Call the state. Call DES.
Discussion of the need for the size of the current central office administrative staff.
That's an idea. Okay.
They're questioning how big the operation is. The cost of the school. So why they chose to do this format, I would say they're ramping up for something bigger. I don't know. But it's going to be ugly. I wish it didn't have to happen.
He's right.
Mr. Early.
It's going to happen regardless of what it is. Doc, you have a lot of information there. I've gotten three or four of those letters. And I just got one recently from Merrimack, business manager, I believe, at Merrimack, asked me to go. I probably know a little about this stuff, but I... Every time I do call the superintendent, he gets back to me. I might not agree with some of the answers, but it's got nothing to do with it. But I will tell you one thing. See that audience out there? We have meetings all the time now. I just saw you a little while ago talking to a gentleman.
Sure.
I felt kind of insulted, but I haven't got much of an education. But I'm going to tell you something. This meeting is posted all the time. On the website?
He's a resident of Merrimack.
Okay, wait a minute.
Okay.
I'm a resident of Havel. I was just in the Merrimack Town Hall. I saw a posting down there of a meeting down here, right? So he doesn't know what he's talking about. And neither do a lot of people that are going to go to that meeting tomorrow night. They can come right out here at our meeting.
I would encourage Mr. Mansfield and the Merrimack rep to be there. To answer questions.
All right, but let's go back.
I have to be there because I'm on the Pawtucket
All right,
School
let's
Committee.
Let's go back
and
to what I'm
committee.
Saying. This stuff is all posted. There's a budget down there in the town of Merrimack. That gentleman you were talking to doesn't even know there was a budget there. He wanted one sent to his house personally. It's not there. It's at the town. Havel gets one. Every town gets one. All right, so this stuff isn't being hidden. All right?
I didn't say it was being hidden.
No, but he said it's not posted. But regardless, it doesn't matter. And the other thing about the school choice.
He's on the administrative board for the school.
Yeah.
If he's having trouble finding when these meetings are, I would listen to that gentleman.
Well, go to the town hall. They can
find
post
out. Find out why he's.
Well, I think we're getting too far here. I would say to these individuals, selectmen, whatever.
Okay.
Kind of reiterate what we said. If you have anything you want to know, come here and we'll answer them. I don't see why we have to have them have I look at this as a separate meeting to discuss what they can find every answer they want right here. We're not going to lie to them. Everything's open. Why do they have to ask themselves questions? If anybody has a question, they can call me, they can call the superintendent, or they can come right here, public comment. Say, I don't like what you're doing. We'll be more than happy to tell them. But for us to have to defend what we're doing, I don't think that's right. Because you just told me it's going to be an ugly meeting. Why is it going to be ugly? Everything is open.
When you have three towns,
right.
First of all, three towns in one community, that's ugly in itself. But
You're right.
Have you been to a selectman's meeting? Yeah, and they're all from the same community. I've worked in this town. I know what it's going to be like. But the questions they have here, to me, there's not a lot of substance to them. But if I were able to say, look, this article here says this, and again, if the superintendent wants to control that, fine. He knew what my questions were. She shared them with the superintendent. Nobody got me any information. So that's not transparency, no. Mr. Chair. That's not transparency.
I agree. I agree that.
You knew my questions. Now I got to go there. I still don't have anything in writing. So it's going to be a witch hunt tomorrow. It's going to be ugly. I'm going to use that word again.
No, I understand it.
I would think
this committee will have to, discuss this. You know, I can't make up my. It's up to the wish of the committee. That as far as. Yes.
Kelly, I just wanted to add, in regard to the admissions policy. As I said, I've been on this committee for over 11 years. We have had this same question come up about our admissions policy. Probably
for 20 years.
I maybe before me.
Right, Paul?
Our admissions policy is passed and guided by the Department of Education. We are called a selective public school. There is criteria. There is no open admissions on a selective public school. The department.
There's two ways they can do it at a selective public school. I forwarded that information to the chair, and he'll agree with me. You could even be taking a lottery. You could accept your students here by lottery, and you can accept them by, setting your limits and your grades. The complaint that these people have is, and it's going to come through tomorrow again, I'm going to read this article right here real briefly just to give you perspective. Just as we talked about, first time I've seen you, Miss Testaverde.
It's Dr. Testaverde.
Dr. Testaverde. First time I've seen you, I don't know how long you've been here, but what is per pupil cost is $18,000, but it receives $5,000 per school of choice, student from the state. I've spoke to this already.
That's true.
The committee know. They feel that the other 11 communities are subsidizing your school of choice. You're picking up the cost. And that's it, right. Now, again, if you say one town complains, no big deal. Two, this is three towns. It's going to get public. It's going to be in the news. And it could grow. It should have been stopped.
I hear you. I think we'll have to take this under advisement and decide what the protocol is now and whether we should change it or not. Beginning. Further comments, Mr. Superintendent? No.
Yes. I know. The school choice issue, Doug, with the $5,000. We're getting $5,000 for an empty seat. Your towns are not subsidizing those kids. Communities that are vested in this school are paying for the building, they're paying for the staff, they're paying for everything else that comprises this school.
The leaders of these three towns.
Well, then you need to explain to them to that.
Then come on to the meeting and explain to them.
You to it.
They feel if you work the, they want to see the school filled with their own community children. That's what they're fighting for.
Beef up the education of their own kids. And this year we didn't have to exclude anybody.
beef up the education. Last thing I'd like to bring,
yes.
Last thing I'd like to bring up, and then it came to my attention that Mr. Gilbert, MASC, represents his school committee. It's a conflict of interest. His wife is on the board. I think we should send a letter to the MASC to send another field director out to represent this board.
I think he'd probably be very happy.
Excuse me. I was the chair on that, and I asked to have Mr. Gilbert come.
Thank you.
For this. Well, I got to say the spade is spade. I asked Mr. Gilbert to come for the superintendent, some clarification for us in which direction to go. Right at the beginning, when we got notice that Mr. DeRosa was leaving, but I was the one that asked Mr. Gilbert to come.
Okay, again, I still feel it's a conflict of interest.
He wasn't charging us. He just gave
the questions that he provided were the direct questions asked to the three candidates.
I wasn't saying that. I said I was the one that brought them.
These are the questions.
He didn't provide.
I'll stay up at night, come up with these.
No.
All right.
Can I just explain?
Yes,
that?
Go ahead. Then we're moving on.
He did not come up with those questions. MASC, Massachusetts Association of School Committees,
right.
Comes up with those questions. He provided them to the chair. The chair chose which ones he wanted to use.
I think it was a boiler list. I think they should have come up with their own. Those questions should have been shaped around then, what this committee wants.
And that's what our questions were afterwards.
Well, listen, we're not gonna solve this here tonight. He's made his point. We will think about it. We will take it under advisement. He has his right to voice his opinion, and we'll discuss it at a later date. I think we have to move on. It's getting a little bit late. We do have need for an executive session. So,
can I,
what?
Mr. Chair, on
yes.
The contact list for all of us, and I brought this up last year too.
Yeah.
On my email address.
Oh, okay.
It's hard to know that that's Elena _ Gilbert because there's a line under the whole thing. It's just the underscore between Elena and Gilbert. So if I know. Doug said he had emailed all of us when he first got on. I never received anything from him, and maybe because my email is...
You misunderstood. I emailed the superintendent.
You said you sent me an email. I'm sorry, and I didn't get it. So
well,
anyway,
whatever.
But
we can fix that.
Just so if anybody needs to reach me, it is _.
All right. Let's move on.
Thank you.
Time is good. I need a motion to enter an executive session.
So
to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining as an open meeting may have the detrimental effect on the bargaining position of the school committee, and upon completion of the executive session, we will return to open session.
Mr. Chairman, clarification?
Yes.
In the minute, in the agenda, it says to discuss strategy with respect to litigation.
And restate what we want.
Oh, well, that's an error.
Okay, thank you.
To restate.
Restated in the executive session. We're going to executive session to discuss respect to the strategy of collective bargaining
contract.
With the contract issues.
Thank you for the clarification.
Mr. Early.
Right.
Yes.
Okay.
Mr. Wood.
Yes.
Mr. Galena.
Yes.
Yes. Ms. Gilbert.
Yes.
Mr. Tucker.
No.
Yes.
Yes. Mr. Irving.
Aye.
Dr. Testaverde.
Yes.
Mr. Bradley. Yes.
Yeah.
Ms. True.
Yes.
Mr. Burns.
Yes.
Ms. Lesage.
Yes.
Take a 5-minute recess, please.
Mr. Chair.
Go. Well, we're back in open session,
those
everybody.
Those are rocked during executive session.
There's a motion on the floor to accept the contract for the next 3 years between the teachers and the school committee.
So moved.
So moved.
Second.
Second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Roll call.
Two abstentions.
Is it roll call?
No, not an open session.
Okay.
Is it roll call? No.
They can. You can call for, you don't need it,
but you have
to call for
it,
a roll
yeah.
call if you want.
You want a roll call?
Roll
yes.
call.
Okay.
Roll call.
Mr. Abstain. Early, abstain. Mr. Wood,
abstain.
Abstain. Mr.
Yes.
Galena.
Yes.
Yes.
Aye.
Aye, Mr.
Yes.
Mr. Abadley. It's true.
Yes.
Yes.
Burns.
Yes.
Yes.
Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.